In the world of classical music, British composer John Tavener is a star. His choral piece Song for Athena was performed at Princess Diana's funeral, and this work, The Protecting Veil, became one of the best-selling classical recordings of all time. Sounds heavenly, doesn't it? And that's not too far off the mark. Just try to congratulate Tavener on his beautiful music, and he'll tell you he was inspired by the Russian Orthodox Church, but the credit belongs to God. Tavener talks about his otherworldly musical philosophy in Music of Silence, A Composer's Testament. He told Steve Paulson the music of silence is like petrified sound.
As when you look at icons and you see the expression on the faces of angels who see God, it has something of frozen ecstasy about it. I think that's really what I mean by silence.
Getting to this point is something that you seem to have strived for, knowingly or not, for a large part of your career as a composer. Before you started to compose this kind of music, you called some of your earlier music exoteric. Can you explain what you mean by that?
Yes. I think I mean that it's music which doesn't have a meaning beyond the notes. It's a music which almost is, I think, a great curse of our times. And, you know, it's art for art's sake. And that I hate that kind of thing altogether. I think, you know, people tend to worship the artist, they worship the notes or the brush strokes, etc., etc. But when you look at truly traditional art, like Egyptian wall paintings or the great art of ancient Greece, one is not aware so much of the person who has created it as one would be with someone like Beethoven. One's very aware of the ego.
Well, it's interesting that you use Beethoven as an example of the direction in music you don't want to go, because I think many people would think of something like Beethoven's Ninth as being an example of music at its most transcendent.
That particular piece I find, I wouldn't say it of all Beethoven, but that particular piece I find, it's a glorification of the human ego and humanism. It has nothing sacred about it.
You are quite critical of the modern world, aren't you?
Well, I feel I sort of don't really belong to it. I would have much preferred to live in ancient Greece or Byzantine Greece, or I wouldn't have minded living amongst the American Indians. And I believe that in great cultures like Hinduism, American Indians, Australian Aborigines, Byzantium, ancient Greece, the music or the art is composed with something the Sufis call the eye of the heart. That is the sort of intellective organ which lies dormant in many of us, but I think there's a tremendous need for it in the world today, and it is that which responds to what is sacred.
I'm curious about how you came to this point in your life to think of music this way. Going back to your childhood, were you very musical then?
Yes, my nanny, she's not alive now, but she always used to tell me the story of when my mother was giving birth to my brother and was away from home, and I'd never experienced that before, but she said that I played music absolutely non-stop. It already was sort of, although the music I played I don't particularly like, but if I play that old 78 record now, which has been scratched to, you know, to pieces almost, if I play that now, it still moves me very much, because in a kind of way it was comforting me. And that possibly brings me on to the fact that I think music can be healing. It can have a healing power. And I think one can't just say, all music is sacred. Some of it is and some of it isn't. I'm not saying that Beethoven wasn't a great composer. I'm sure he was. But it doesn't have this quality of the sacred. I think the last pieces he wrote, when he was really facing death, and probably he was exhausted, It's almost as if he doesn't bother anymore, or he can't be bothered anymore to develop it. They are quite exquisite, and I think they come directly from the divine.
Well, let me ask you about the way you compose some of your pieces. I mean, you've written that you composed The Lamb, one of your best-known pieces, in a quarter of an hour.
Yes, I think the short pieces come to me very quickly. Blake used to say that everything that he wrote was divinely dictated. I've no idea whether that is the case with me, but it appears to come from somewhere I don't know. And it seems to be totally fresh, not in this modern concept of being innovatory or novelty. Novelty and innovation means absolutely nothing to me at all. The only person who is the creator is God. And the only person who can make anything new is Christ. He said, "Behold, I make all things new."
I'm wondering, though, what that means when you actually sit down to compose a score. I mean, what does it mean to say that God is composing through you?
I think it's a question of Kumaraswamy, the great Indian. He was a kind of philosopher, and he knew about all religions, but he said about education, he said, you know, one spends 4 years going to university and the rest of your life unlearning everything you've learned at the university. So, to give a simple example, I think to unlearn what you've learned about sonata form, what you've learned about canon, what you've learned about counterpoint, what you've learned about serialism and every other ism that exists, and actually to go into one's room, and I always regard my study as a kind of sanctuary, because that's where my music seems to happen. And going into that room and literally sitting in front of a piece of blank paper, and just, I don't sort of cross my legs on the floor and meditate in that kind of way, but just emptying my mind of all preconceived ideas and seeing what remains. And I've been lucky enough, thanks to God, to find that something does remain. And I think it's that remains which is sacred. So it's a question of waiting and just being silent and listening, because that music already exists. I believe when God created the world, he created everything, so therefore he created music. And so that music is out there. That music does exist if one can be, dare I say, I don't mean that I'm humble, I'm not, but if one can be humble enough to empty oneself of preconceived ideas of what music should be, then you will find there is, at least I have found that the music is there. And I don't know where it comes from. It seems unfamiliar very often, but it does exist.
Composer John Tavener says he feels most at home in Greece, but thoroughly enjoys the fresh spirituality of America. You can read about John Tavener's sacred music in the book The Music of Silence, A Composer's Testament. He talked with Steve Paulson.